Barack Obama leaves tomorrow for his last major overseas trip as president of the United States. As he is heading to Greece, Germany, and Peru, European Union foreign ministers met in Brussels today to discuss the impact of the incoming Trump administration. NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg wrote in a newspaper article this weekend that, quote, European leaders have always understood that when it comes to security, going it alone is not an option. President-elect Trump's stated positions on security, trade, and relations with countries like Iran are a departure from the policies of the past 8 years under President Obama. Joining me now from Boston to take a closer look is New York Times national security correspondent David Sanger. David, you interviewed with your colleague Maggie Haberman Donald Trump a couple of times last spring, and he spoke about a couple of different issues of foreign policy, and I'd like to go through a couple of them, NATO being one of them. He described NATO as obsolete. Why did he describe it that way?
Well, his view, Alison, is that NATO ought to be focused completely on terrorism. That it is, as you said, an obsolete institution. And he said almost nothing about its role, its traditional role, in helping contain Russia and before that the Soviet Union. I asked him at one point if some of the new members of NATO, or newer members, who were previously Soviet states, if they were invaded, would he come to their defense, which is, of course, required under the NATO treaty? And instead of offering the assurance first, he said, well, first I'd check and see what their level of contribution had been to NATO. And that's quite a departure, because the commitments the United States and other members have are basically an attack on one is an attack on all. Now, the question is this a negotiating tactic, or does this indicate a fundamental rethinking of what NATO should be?
It's interesting. One of the goals of NATO for its 28 members is that each will spend about 2% of its GDP on defense. And as of 2015, only five of the 28 countries had done so, the United States being one of them. So in his mind, is this transactional? You haven't contributed, so if you're going to depend on us, we expect something from you?
Well, Alison, I think you've gotten at the core of what is one of the big differences between the Trump worldview and the conventional worldview, including his own party's. That in the years or the decades since World War II and since the creation of NATO more than 50 years ago, the concept has been that alliances are about more than any individual transaction. They're building a relationship, building a common defense, and that relationship is something that you work on each year, and you don't keep a strict ledger book. His view, both in Europe and in Asia, is quite different. It's that these are transactional relationships, that if the United States is running a trade deficit with a country for which it is also providing protection, that trade deficit ought to get in line so that we are not losing money. When he said that he would be willing to pull American troops out of Japan and South Korea, it was because, in his view, they weren't paying all of the costs. They pay, in Japan's case, about half the cost of keeping troops there. So there wasn't a concept that keeping troops forward deployed was in America's own interest as well as in the interest of its allies.
I want to read one more line from that op-ed that UN Secretary General, NATO Secretary General wrote. He wrote, "This is no time to question the value of the partnership between Europe and the United States." What's the subtext of that? Are we talking about Russia? Are we talking about Syria?
I think you're talking about both. I mean, Russia will be one of the first great tests, and it'll be a test in the debate over NATO, and it'll be a test in the debate over Syria. Now, President-elect Trump gave a brief interview to the Wall Street Journal on Friday, in which he said that he would rethink one of the fundamental tenets of the American policy toward Syria, which has been to help arm and train opposition groups to President Assad. And in Mr. Trump's view, and this is consistent back to the interviews we did with him in March and again in July, the United States should not be trying to knock Assad out of office or even encouraging a situation in which he would get overthrown, despite the fact that he's responsible for the deaths of nearly 500,000 of his own citizens. Because in his view, the one goal in the Middle East should be fighting ISIS, and if Assad is also fighting ISIS, we ought to get together with him and the Russians. What we haven't heard him fully explain here is that would put us on the same side of the fight with the Iranians as well. And as you know, he's got pretty strong opinions about Iran.
At one point, David, candidate Trump said, "My number one priority is to dismantle the disastrous deal with Iran." How might he do that?
Well, one way he could dismantle it is to simply announce that the United States was reimposing sanctions on Iran, not for anything in the nuclear sphere. In fact, the Iranians have abided pretty much by what's within the four corners of the nuclear deal, but by putting sanctions on them for their support of terrorism, for their support of Hezbollah, their actions in Syria, and so forth. Now, if they did that, the Iranians might say, hey, look, this is not within the spirit of the agreement. You took sanctions that we removed from the nuclear deal and simply reimposed them with another excuse. And that's something the United States said it would not do during the Obama administration. That would probably serve to unravel the deal, but it's probably the Iranians who would take the first step toward doing the unraveling in that case.
David Sanger of the New York Times, thanks for sharing your reporting.
Thank you, Alison.